Om Shri Sai Ram. Now I have the pleasant duty of introducing the next speaker for this session. Our next speaker is Dr. C. Murali Krishna. Dr. Murali Krishna, presently the scientific officer G and also heads the Chilakapati lab, Education in Cancer, which is under the umbrella of Tata Memorial Center, Mumbai. His research interests include developing cost-effective Raman spectroscopic diagnostic methods for specific and sensitive detection of cancers and various diseases in the very early stages. Through his research, Dr. Krishna has extensively contributed to the early diagnosis of oral cancer. Dr. Krishna is the first person to demonstrate in vivo Raman spectra of oral cancer subjects and the diagnosis of the earliest events in oral cancer, such as pre-malignant subjects and the cancer field effects in clinically implementable time. He has successfully shown oral cavity can be treated as a single entity through Raman-based screening, and his findings are major steps towards the cure. He has also focused on developing Raman microspectroscopy for diagnosis using cell smear, serum, plasma, and tissue microsections. His studies suggest that utility of serum Raman in diagnosis of asthma, malaria, and dengue subjects. Coming to his career and achievements, Dr. Murali Krishna received his PhD degree from the Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics, Calcutta, and completed his postdoctoral work from Biophysics Laboratory, CRNS, France. He was a recipient of fellowships such as FAP-SCP Fellowship from Brazil and BOYS-CAT Fellowship from DST Government of India. He is part of several international collaborations such as European Union, Indo-US program, Indo-Finnish program, and Indo-Mexican programs. Dr. Krishna is a member of many scientific communities such as International Society for Clinical Spectroscopy, UK, the International Society of Optics and Photonics, USA, life member of Indian Society of Radiation and Photochemical Sciences, Society of Biological Chemists, Society for Cancer Research and Communication. Dr. Murali Krishna has been very actively involved in academic teaching. He was an associate professor at Manipal Academy of Higher Education till 2007 and was also a visiting faculty at Biophysics Laboratory, CRNS, France. Dr. Krishna has been the visiting faculty to the University of Reims at France since 2002. Dr. Krishna has guided more than 10 PhD students so far. Coming to his publications, he has more than 135 publications and 15 book chapters and one book to his credit. Now, Dr. Krishna will be speaking to us on Raman theranostics in healthcare. Over to Dr. Krishna.
First of all, big thanks to for this invitation and very kind words about this introduction by Dr. Borshik and others. It's a wonderful conference, I can see that, because I've been two very interesting talks by I think you and Swanindra, wonderful topics on imaging, actually multiphoton and also MRI imaging, and especially very relevant to the existing COVID issues. So now I think I'll take you to completely different topics. Basically, it's Raman-based theranostics. What I mean by theranostics is a tool which can be used to kind of diagnostic applications, also can be used to therapeutic monitoring. That's what I mean by this word theranostics. That means same techniques can be used to kind of to the diagnose or screen the disease, also can follow the therapeutic applications. That's the that's what I mean by this title. And I in the outline, what I'm trying to do is I'm just going to talk about Raman spectroscopy. Essentially, I'm going to talk about Raman first, because he's the very interesting personality who discovered this phenomena, and also instrumentation and other things. And in clinical applications, I spend more time on cancer, because you know that has been our mandate here. We worked on several cancers, mostly in head, neck, and cervical has been our area of interest. And also I'll talk about few non-cancer disease applications. And I try to not to show you a lot of data, but rather show you the applications, because that makes easy for all of us. So if you look at the scientists in British area, pre-independence area, we have a lot of people like Minna Saha, then Bose, and all these people. And among them, definitely Dr. Raman, Sir Raman is a star. And if you look at him, he was the first, he stood first in MSc without attending classes. and published paper in 1906, and it happens to be first paper from Presidency College of Madras, now Chennai. Then he moved to as a Auditor General to Calcutta. Then he got into ISCS, Indian Institution of Cultivation of Science. Then the rest is the history. Then, if you look at these things, he's the first man to get a Nobel Prize. And he announced this discovery in 1928, and which we call as a National Science Day, and we recently celebrated it. And he's he's very serious about research. Highly national. I think you could hear what I said before. So essentially, he's a very, very, very nationalistic in his mindset. And it's a great incident, they say, after picking up the Nobel Prize, he was kind of crying because he saw, first he thought Nobel Prize for him, then later on it's for India. Then he found there was no Indian flag, but it was a Union jacket at the time. So that was him. Then also, he has very, very strong opinions about many things. Like, for example, he thinks that it's especially for the young people. What is important for quality of science is freshness of outlook, rather than looking at maturity and all those things or not. It's basically freshness and how quickly you can look. And also about Indian mind, he says that we have a little lack of courage. I think even these comments, he wants to hold good. And if you can come out of it, you'll be definitely successful doing things. And also he thinks that foreign education, he don't say that foreign education doesn't make huge difference, but all he says is interest for science comes within yourself. That's what he means. Okay, now with this, I thought I should speak about Raman because, he's a man who actually created a huge impact on Indian science. I thought I should speak a few words on that too. I use his technique for the last 2 to 2 years, so I thought it's my job to talk about him. Then let's talk about Raman effect. You can see this on the screen. There's a lot of green lights going on. Then there's a molecule here. When it hits, you see that green light, many green lights are coming. Also, there are other lights coming of different colors. And the lights which come in the same frequency as heat, these are the basically Rayleigh. And all other things, what you see are different colors, these are the Raman photons. Now, there's an interesting story about how this man got into this field. One argument is he has, like any big man, as you grow, you have people who talk good about you and bad about you. Because some people believe that he was just a copycat, he was trying to copy what Compton did for access to light. But his opinion, at least Dr. G.V. Raman's book, who happened to be our Vice Chancellor, I think, sometime back. In his book, he says completely different story. What he tells is, actually, that time existing theory was the color of sea is just reflection of the sky, color of the sky. That was the theory which Lord Rayleigh has proposed. And when he was traveling from 1921 from London to Bombay, he felt it's not true because the color of the sea changed as he traveled. So then he did some experiments, and by the time he reached Bombay, I think he presented a paper to Nature, a letter, saying that it's nothing to do with the reflection of the what you see the sky, but it's basically it's a scattering of the liquids. That was his theory, and he kept on trying working on that. So this is that fundamental great paper which he published in March 1928, where he discussed, yes, when you hit the lights in the liquids or gases, you see a same light, diffuse radiation of ordinary kind, having same wavelength, what you call as a Rayleigh. But it also accompanied by a degraded second radiation. That's what he call as Raman. Actually, the Raman did not call himself, which is the Raman effect. It's basically Bose. S.N. Bose was also a contemporary, was in Calcutta. Then he said he did a wonderful thing and you get a Nobel Prize for it and it should be called Raman effect. That's what happened later on. So again, these things, what I'm trying to tell you is like how fierce he was in publishing papers, how he was trying to put his things. For example, if you look at March 1928 to June 1928, he had 1, 2, 3, several papers by himself. If you look at like almost every 2 weeks he was publishing a paper. I think that I was told it's 2 weeks because that was the time you need the doc to come, and that was the kind of time he was doing, and it was pre-independence area and communication was a problem, but still you can see that. And he also had competitors from different groups, and he could able to present saying that yes, and he could able to get Nobel Prize for his work. And this tells you that you really have to when you pursue, you should very actively pursue to show what you are. I think that is a lesson from what Dr. Raman wants to tell us. We should be very hardworking and we should publish it also. Then what you measure in Raman, basically what you measure is basically vibrational modes of the molecules. As you can see, the simple methane buttons, how many number of vibrational modes are coming. It's crisscrossing and symmetric and asymmetric, stretching, scissorings, all kinds of modes will come. And in case of a lower one is a aromatic compound which shows the ring breathing modes to different vibrational modes. And interesting part is all these things can give you very strange and different lines. So each vibrational mode has a line, and this gives you the fingerprint of the molecule. So now the question is, when we talk about the instrumentation of Raman, a very important point of Raman is the, basically at this point of time, is the filters where you remove the Rayleigh. You have the laser hitting the sample, then the molecule gets vibration, then you get Rayleigh, same line, and also you see the Raman lines, and you have to have a good notch filter to remove the Rayleigh and correct it. That's how the whole instrument goes. And this scheme is what Raman has tried. He just put a violet filter to get a violet out, then you have a molecule, then you put a violet filter to a green filter to cut out the this one, the what's coming from the violet line, and only allow the green to come on. And he measured, he pumped violet and got a different color. That's what he was trying to see. Basically, one is basically the Rayleigh line, other is basically the Raman line. That's what he tried to see, and all his instrument was basically eye. And if you look at now, the progress of Raman instrumentation, something 1928, starting with eyes, you know, the eye-based detection. So now we have already reached, space. We are in right now in the Mars. It's part of the rover now. So that's what is the great progress made. And there's a lot of, a lot of things have really progressed actually. There's a lot of developments in that case. If you look at Raman instrument, as I told you, he used the sunlight and used a couple of filters to see, and using eye, he was detecting the change in the frequency from what has been targeted or what has been impinged on. And this is the electron is shifted to photographic plates. This instrument you can see in IIC Bangalore. In me, I joined somewhere in 1998, where our instruments were like this. This is the laser, then we have beam steering optics, which take you the sample somewhere here. We put a sample somewhere here. It was a biopsies. Then the Raman is collected here. The CCD and spectrographs are here. So that's how we started. Then we improved. Now we have reached such a stage. You can see that hardly there is anything, because yes, it's basically all beam steering optics are taken away, and we have just fiber probes to take the light and bring it back. Then you have a laser and a spectrograph and CCD. And in fact, laptop becomes the biggest component of the instrumentation. So from this to this, we reached in about a decade time. Then we played around the instruments. Actually, what you can see, this was the instrument which we have used for oral cancers. Then we have used this same little modifications we have used for fiber probes have been little modified to work on cervical cancers. Then on animal models, animal experiments. Then also we did something to do with the microscopic applications also. So now the question is, all we know is Raman gives fingerprint, because that's what we have seen, vibrational modes. Then how that is connected to disease diagnosis? This was the scheme which tells you why it is connected. What generally we feel is when the light is hit to the excited tissue or sample, anything, there can be scattering, there can be fluorescence, there can be absorption, whatever it is, depending on what are you measuring. And whatever you measure, it tells you what is happening in the system. Especially in case of Raman scattering, what we expect is it gives a metabolic fingerprinting, it gives a kind of metabolomics kind of thing, it tells you what kind of molecules have changed during this place. So whole hypothesis is when tissue has changed from, when the person's condition has changed from healthy to disease situation, there should be some kind of changes in the molecular things here, and that we can catch by Raman scattering. That's what essentially what we are trying to do it here. And and we'll see how this hypothesis works in disease diagnosis. That's what going to be my next 20-30 minutes I'm going to speak about it. Then this is a flowchart, how exactly we work. What we do is we do the spectrum. Then we have some analysis by unsupervised or supervised classifications. Generally, we use the first step to see whether there is any, suppose you record spectra of, say, healthy and disease conditions, are the spectra are same or spectra are different. To do that, we do a PCA first. Suppose PCA works, then we go for we try to develop the models using PCLDA. And these models will be evaluated by 11-hour cross validation or by the the blinded samples. Blinded samples will tell you how accurately you can predict a sample as healthy or not healthy. That tells you the your models are correct or not correct. So how you do about the spectrum? Basically, the spectra you have to do certain corrections. Depends on the what kind of instrument you are doing. In our in vivo instrument, we used to do this kind of correction. We used to have CCD response correction. We have background correction interpolation. That is, you record spectra, say maybe from 400 to 3400 or about 2000, but generally depending on the what range you are working. But mostly we use 800 to 1800 or 600 to 1800. That's our fingerprint region. That's very important for us because that's where you get all the information. Then we do it. And the baseline correction, we used to do a first derivative. Now we don't do first derivative. In first derivative, because you know the reason by for going for first derivative based the background correct, the baseline correction is this is objective. Yeah, otherwise you do a baseline, you can baseline can be different, depends on the person to person, it can vary. So all idea of the entire using all these processes to make things simple, and it's not depend on the operator, it should be independent of the operator so that models can be used in long term, stuff like that. And there we need to do normalization because the basically we're collecting scattering. It all depends on suppose the operator is good, we focus it well, and the laser is slightly higher level, then you get a bad signal, otherwise you don't get a might get a slightly feeble signal. So the moment you normalize in the vector normalization or the highest peak normalization, all the intensity variations are gone. Now only looking at the ratios, relative intensity of the bands. So that makes more reliable analysis. These are the steps how the spectra look like from different stages. Then basically we use MATLAB-based analysis. Now we are using Unscrambler for this. Then we do cross validation, basically 11-hour cross validation or test prediction we use. The overall thing is like, then how you present the data. One is the scatter plot, where each of them will talk about one spectrum, basically each colors and how these three groups are separate. Or we use a confusion matrix. Confusion matrix, ideally, if everything is correct, you can see that all the diagonal elements will have numbers. All non-diagonal elements should be zero. That means, suppose group A, if it is good, it will show as 15 all group A and doesn't show anything group B or group C. So that will tell you how good, how accurate, how bad is your analysis. That means your diagonal elements have to be correctly classified. That means the number should be higher. That means your model is correct. Then there are two different ways we do analysis. For example, when you work on in vivo measurements, we use each spectrum as spectrum. That's what we call a spectra wise. That is, each spectrum is considered as a sample, and we don't try to do anything, just use them. In case of patient wise, what we do in case of, for example, this happens especially when we are working in vivo samples, where each spot is a point for us because we want to do surgical demarcations and other things. So for that, it is important to use spot to spot. When you go to samples like saliva or serum or cells, so what happens is you are using a microscope. When you are using a actually in vivo, the another reason why we have to change is in case of in vivo, we are using a spot of 100 microns to excite and about 200 microns to pick up. So you are reasonably larger area to you are probing it. And when you go to serum or saliva or these things, exfoliated cells or something, which are basically, you know, you are using a microprobe based work. When you do a microprobe based work, what happens is your spot size becomes very small. It can become, depending on the objective, it can be 2 microns or 3 microns or something like that. So when you take a sample like 30 microliters, which we need, maybe a biomarker can be anywhere in the drop. It need not to be where you picked up. So to avoid this problem, what we do is we record about 10 spectrum in the sample, and we average them to get one spectrum for sample. So that way we try to say that we have kind of got the entire information from the drop, so it gives more representative spectrum. And we do that analysis and what we call it as patient-wise. That means suppose we record 10 spectrum from a patient, serum sample or exfoliate cells, whatever it is. Now we are using, that turns out to be one spectrum for the person. So that is more representative and both spectrum. So I'll talk about oral cancers. These are some of the things. The reason why we need to work is basically, one of the common cancers across the world. And more importantly, it's a problem of developing countries, and more so for the India, because we get about 100,000 cases every year, and half of them, you know, like 56, this is the kind of ratio we have, and half of them die. It's very fun, you know, it's a very, very sad situation because it's so accessible tumor. Why? And we have treatment, we have surgeries can be done very nicely. It's not so complicated to do this, I say, but why people die? It's because late detection. That's one of the reasons. And these are, tobacco is a big killer, and also alcohol. Generally, together, does more problem. And it's a simple visual examination can reduce the, I know that deaths by very long, a very, very big number that you can see here. You can see by, it's a big study conducted in the Kerala for about 10 years by, sorry, I'm not reading the name. So Shankar Narayan conducted this study. So about lakhs of people are analyzed. What he found is he looked at the risk people and tried to give them health education and give them the visual examination. And by that, they could cut down the deaths by half. And visual examination is not always a great technique. That means a simple visual examination can reduce the depth so much. By doing a better technique, we can improve it. So, but why is the problem in identifying the head neck cancers using present clinical techniques? One of the problem is, it's purely depends on the how you recognize the minor changes by clinical eye or clinical examination. So it depends on the clinician's capability to pick up changes. That's the first point. Second point is you have to, then the biopsy has to go to a pathologist. And so especially in case of very early cancers, it becomes very difficult to where to pick up the biopsy, that is a surgeon's capability. And the pathologist has to be very careful to pick up the small changes. So these two, getting a good biopsy and good pathologist examination, that makes a huge difference. And it all depends on how good is the person. And patients always don't like to come for the biopsies. And another serious problem with head neck cancer is most of the cancers go through something called precancerous conditions like leukoplakia, erythroplakia, OSMF, and all those things. Like you can see some patches and you see the mouth opening is a problem. This kind of things happen. And they eventually go into cancers. But this conversion of cancer to the precancer to cancers are not high. They are about 10-15% to, I think, OSMF, maybe lesser to leukoplakia and erythroplakia. But the question is, suppose you find somebody who is having a leukoplakia or something, is it leukoplakia with cancer or early cancer? You can't do it because you need to have a surveillance and a biopsy, which is difficult because there are a lot of cases like this. So issue is, oral cancer diagnosis is not difficult when it is late stage, but it's very difficult when it is very early cases. And very early cancers to pick up is a huge challenge. So that's where we picked up. And these are the, some of the work what we did in 1998 when I was in Manipal. That's where we started. The first paper came in 2001 in Current Science, where we showed that biopsy can be collected, can be spectra, can be recorded. It was about 115 biopsies, 24 early cases. That is, we call contralateral. That is, suppose they have got, so left side is the tumor, right side becomes a contralateral for you. That is healthy part. That's how we work on that. So when you look into this, we could able to see that there are two different spectra. Spectra are very different across patients, and it is workable. Then we went to the next stage. We tried to add premalignant conditions and also inflammatory conditions, and we see that it works. We can able to classify them. They are very different. Healthy people are very, very different. You can see them. Healthy people are very, very different from other cases. That was our second study, which came in 2006. And by then, we were sure that it works. So the question was, what next? Because if we still we have to get a biopsy, then the whole purpose is gone. So that's where we tried to see, is it possible that we can make a fiber-based studies and we can just get a fiber to take the light and record spectrum? Because, you know, this was in Manipal. You can see this wall. There used to be a small hole here. So what you can take, you can take a fiber through that hole. This fiber can go through the hole and patient can come the other side and record spectrum. That was the whole attempt we wanted to try, but somehow it did not work. So then that was the same time I was also working with a French group. We had who had very strong collaborations with Jovinway, and that time it was called Dilor, Raman Micro Raman Instruments. So with them, we tried to work on the the system, and this is the kind of spectrograph design we thought we should be fine for us, because it's a very small spectrograph, CCD, and it works. But when we got this instrument, they also came up with something called Superhead. This Superhead gives all the ones which cuts off the Rayleigh light and all those clears the excitation lines. All the filters are here, but this is not a very interesting one, because when you can't just put it into a person's mouth, it will be scary. That's where we work with Infotronics to come up with some minor changes. What happens is this fiber, there is a lens here, which is about 5 millimeters, is the focus point. Now, what we did, we made them to put the lens at this one corner, which has a slight, there's a screws there. So what we did, we can put a kind of bolt, kind of, we can put back a, you know, like a spacer, which is about exactly 5 millimeters, with additional glass on the top, kind of say, calcium fluoride kind of thing, so that it will not go. And this spacer, now it can be taken out. And suppose you record one person, then when you put another person, you can put another spaces. Suppose you have 10, 15 spaces like this, then you can work on 10, 15 patients very easily. And this can be, now you can disinfect them. So it becomes easier to work. That's where we started this work. And we started in, by the time we come up to this stage, was about 2011, we first reported that spectra can be recorded on the patient in 5 seconds. Then we started working on the premalignants, how we can classify premalignants or not. Then also, we also worked on, so then the other question came, suppose there are patients who are premalignant conditions or other things, but there are also people, different age groups. See, earlier concept was cancers come to only old people, but later on we realized that cancers can come also early, very young people, about 25, 30 years. So what we did was we recorded spectra of people who are of different ages, starting from 20 to 30, 30 to 40, 40 to 50, 50 to 60. Then also we recorded spectra of all other conditions and we tried to see whether they do come, they do classify or they don't classify. Yes, none of them classify, age doesn't matter. That was a first impression, so that this technique is useful. I'm not showing the data because of, I can show you only one data which tells you what is the final stage of it. So I thought I'm not showing here. Then, as Dr. Gauri Shankar was saying, we picked up the earliest changes. That's called cancer food effects. These are very important in the head and neck cancers, because head and neck cancers mostly come from, say, smoke, tobacco, or alcohol. These are carcinogens. That is, entire mouth is, entire cavity has been disturbed. Now the entire cavity has a problem. Now this cavity can give a second cancer. I will show you the next slide. So now our idea was, is it possible to pick up such early changes by taking spectra of a smoker, non-smoker, a healthy people? Can we pick up or not? That was the first thing. Yes, we could able to show that. And another point is, interesting aspect is, there are in head neck, there are three sites which are very common we get cancers, that is buccal, then we have tongue, we have lip. Now it is important to see whether all these three cancers have to be identified separately, or all these things have to be used as one site. That was another question we had. That means when you build up the model, okay, buccal cancer model, buccal healthy, buccal normal, buccal, all these things. Or is lip everybody, tongue everybody. Or can we call, okay, we don't care all the sites, we are same. So this is another thing which we worked, and it does work. It does do a good job. I can show that data to you. This is based on about 72 subjects and 85 which on tumors and contralaterals. That is, contralateral is the people who have got a cancer, but other side of the cancer, where the clinician says there is no cancer. Then we have premalignants, 40 people, different age groups. How it look like? If you look at here, this is healthy. You see, these are the three groups, buccal, lip, and tongue. These are different. The moment you go to contralateral means the disease condition, but there is no disease on the given site where there actually this starts slowly mixing up. The moment you go to premalignant, this classification becomes much more difficult, unlike healthy. The moment you go to tumor, there is no classification, all look the same. This is more clear, you can see from this picture. If you see this picture, all greens, they are the healthy people. There are about 1,100 sites we have recorded on the healthy people. And we have recorded 590 as a number of sites, almost 1,100 kind of things, the contralateral and other things. If you look at the crosstalk between these two, is very minimal. Almost one spectra or two spectra here and there. That shows that a person who is healthy, it can be just by spectrum, you can tell, yes, this guy is healthy. And there is no question about the healthy guy getting into other site. So that is the level of classification you could able to pick up, and you could able to do a good job. So, and none of these pathological conditions go here. So it's a good screening tool. We all suspected people just record spectra, and they're healthy, just push them other side. And whoever is going other side, you can work on them to try to see what we can do to them. So that way you can reduce the burden on the health system. That is one of the important points we can do here. And we don't need to bother about whether it's coming, whether you recorded spectra from buccal or you recorded spectra from lip or tongue. It doesn't matter. Any oral cavity spectra is fine. It works. This was, I was talking to you, what you call as cancer field effect. This is a healthy one. All was well. Then there was a one plaque has come. This is where the tumor started. Then the plaques goes off. Then you get a tumor here. This is a very early stage of a precocious lesion. This is where the cancer has started. Now this cancer has grown. This cancer has been removed. But there are other cancers somewhere here, which we don't know. Because it can't be identified. They are undetectable because in biopsy, visually you can't see them. They are different. Since they are different, I mean, they can't be differentiated by a clinical eye. And there cannot be any biopsy to confirm. Even biopsy also doesn't show a difference. Now what happened after a few years, this cancer will come. So this recurrence is a huge problem in head and neck cancers. At least 30 to 40% of cases it seems to recur. So unless we sort out this problem also, this solution doesn't help. So that is where we also started working. So we published one letter on the surgical margins. We said, yes, surgical margins are possible. We can do that means. Now when surgeon is removed, his calculation is, okay, tumor is this much big, and I take 2 centimeters from here, or 1.5 centimeters, 1 centimeters, he takes off that area. But is it correct? That was our argument. Our argument is not correct. You can do a surgical margins. And second point, what we kept on saying is, when you record spectra on the healthy side also, which you think healthy, and match it with the non-healthy area, if they match, there can be small tumor. Because, as I said, there may be something small kind of things which you can't see. It could be very micro tumor. Now, suppose spectra recorded here are matching. That means there is a possibility that this particular area can become cancerous maybe in next few months or few years. So such person can be asked to come again and again. And also, since it is a basically non-invasive method, all you need is just person comes, just record spectrum and okay, as long as all is well, there's no tumor, right? Not going to tumor spectrum site. You can ask to go back and you can come once in 6 months. So this is very important from the point of view of managing this early identification of a second tumor, which is a huge problem in neck cancers. It's because most of the time when the second cancer comes, it's not necessarily that surgeon failed. It's a problem of the disease. So that can be sorted out. And recently we came up with another study, which is just published in Lasers in Medical Sciences. What we sure it is, yes, suppose we record spectrum, and now, because most of the spectra are recorded around 2011-12, now it's about 10 years old, we know how many people have survived, how long they survived, we have complete data. Now we try to see these two things, spectra of the people recorded from contralateral and the tumor site, their matchings, and how long they survived. Then when we did that, we could find there is a correlation of the spectral markers to the disease risk survival. So we can also tell surgical margins. We can also tell, can we identify the early feasibility of or the potential second tumors in a person. You can also kind of estimate a person's disease free stage. So this gives Raman spectroscopy gives good idea. And all these things can be done on simply spectra recorded on the person, which is about say 5 to 10 seconds. That's all. There is no pain. Nothing. So we did also cervical cancers and good number of cases. And why we have to do cervical cancers is basically it's also very complicated cancer for Indian point of view. It's 80% of cervical cancers occur in India, I mean developing countries like India. And the Western world had this problem, especially in their rural areas. But they have a very strong screening tools by pap test and other things, so they reduce the burden a lot. But whereas we don't have that kind of mechanism here in countries like India, so that's where we have this problem. So we need a tool which can be non-invasively identify it. So these are the etiology, HPV or oral contraceptive, smoking, number of children and diet. These are some of the issues. And anyway, these are the cytology, which is the screening tool. They have their own limitations. And eventually, finally, histopathology, like head neck cancer, you take a biopsy and just can verify it. It takes about a week to tell you. And as usual, like same story, like in head necks, this also needs the expertise. And most of the unfortunate thing is most of the time, cervical cancers also come up with stage 3 and ERB, which is basically you know, like reasonably, you know, late detections. So the one of the problems what we noticed in this case of cervical cancer is, we suppose when you want to compare one spectrum versus another spectrum, another group, all you need is you need a control. In case of mouth cancers, we have a control which is in the same person, mouth where there is a tumor, there is a place where there is no tumor. But unfortunately, in cervical cancers, there is no such place, or we can't make identify. And we did there were some doubts, does it work or not? So what we did, we took commercial microscope, we recorded spectra of commercial microscope, our own microscope with different lights, and we saw that it works. That was in 2013. Then also we saw in 785 our own light, this one, and also works. Then later on, what we did was, all these cases, they were only controls and tumors. That means healthy people and the tumor subjects. But in this case, when we went to final this, we looked at different conditions, healthy and pre-malignants, and also a disease stage. So tell that it works or not. Now I show you that data to you. So this is oral pre-malignant conditions. We have healthy people, we have oral cancers, we have disease control. This is brain tumors, basically. So this is about the number of public view analyzed. So what we did two groups study. That means you put this as healthy, this is the green, and these are all disease conditions, what we call as abnormal. When you look into it, identifying as normal is about 83%, and abnormal was less, fine. But as long as you can identify out of 80-85% of people healthy as healthy, that much you have reduced burden on the patient, on the health system. So then what we suggested them is, fine, you do that. Then once you feel they are abnormal, then build models for different conditions like, you know, oral cancers, disease, pre-malignants, maybe tobacco, later on you can add any number of models here, and look at the spectrum where it goes. By that, by two model system, healthy versus abnormal, first identify healthy is healthy or not, then go for all other diseases, and you can do a good disease diagnosis. At least you can do a good screening here, and you can also get an idea about which side it is going. Is it going to a pre-malignant condition, or it's going to a different disease, or it's going to a cancer, that you can pick it up. So that was our study. And also what we did was, can we use same serum, the serum-based Raman spectroscopy to identify people who are, whether surgery is done properly or not, or whether there is a recurrent case or not. So generally what happens when a person comes, you do a surgery. After surgery, there will be, you know, like inflammatory conditions will be there. So you take one sample from the surgery, before surgery or anesthesia is given. Then you take another sample once the patient is ready to discharge, about a week or something. Then he comes for the first visit. You take another sample. Anyway, we have to do it for routine, so you just add another maybe half ml or something, because you need about 30 microliters to do it. Then when we analyze the data, what we found is that subjects who have a recurrence can be picked up almost 80 to 90% success rate based on the spectrum recorded after the surgery. The before surgery sample doesn't help anyway, because there is a tumor all the time. But when surgery is done, because all the tumor-based markers are gone from the serum, when you record spectrum, then you find there is another, you know, the person, whether it could be two things. One, surgery is incomplete. Maybe some other tumor was somewhere there or something which clinician has missed it. Or maybe that what I told you in the cancer field effect, there is a small tumor coming up which he could not identify. In either of the cases, we can tell the patient, tell the subject that you need to be examined again. That we can tell. Once surgery is done, we need not to say that all is well with you. We can, after getting the serum sample, we can compare with what is happening. From that, we can tell, yes, you are done, you are fine. Or we can say, fine, you need to be observed. This can be done very easily, just by a 30 microliter sample. And also we have used, next stage, we went for the saliva. Saliva is a very, you know, unlike, you know, like blood, the only problem is, you know, you have to be careful with HPV infections, HIV infections, all those things, which are not here in the most, generally with saliva, easy to handle, you get as number of times as possible. That is one thing. And it gives markers in both ways. One, whenever the tumor starts growing, it starts shedding a light, you know, cells. Why? Because, you know, that there is a competition for food, so it has to go somewhere else. There is also necrosis, because lack of food, it start dying. So markers will come like this. So in saliva, which is very close to tumor, We have samples, the markers coming from here like this. And also through the fluids, other junctions, other things, we also get it. So that means it's a good source of biomarkers from directly and indirect mechanism also. So this is a good way of doing it. So what we did in this case is, we recently published this one where we standardized the tool. What we did, we took a saliva, we air dried it, just put a sample for some, maybe 30 minute or two dries, just put another drop, so that you get layers after layers. Or lyophilize the sample, just a semi-liquid kind of things you try it. This is because saliva is a very weak sample, so you need to concentrate. Third thing, what we did the centrifugation, took the pellet and took the supernatant and recorded spectrum. When you analyzed it, air dried, lyophilized, they just club together, they just mismatch and all those things happen. But when you look at pellet and supernatant, they are very, very different. They don't match with any of other things. So from this, our understanding is, maybe air drying or lyophilization better because they retain all the parameters which are there in other groups also. So this gives the whole saliva information. So what we did, we took air dried samples, about 30 patients, healthy volunteers in Cuba, and we found it works around 90%. We are able to classify them well. So that's with a saliva-based technology, if you can do that, that's a good way of doing it. In fact, we increased the number of cases now. Our classification is much, much higher. I'm not showing this data here, it's to be published, but it works. Now we are also adding to them other ones, tobacco and other groups, criminal living conditions and all those things to enrich and see how best it works. Then exploit, I told you the other way of looking at it is look at the, cells from the area. So you just can just collect cells like this. And you take the cells, collect them and put them here, record spectrum, this side. And then take the same pellet and do the tap to confirm what is this. And same method I told you, what we made with the same instrument, what we kind of jugadu for serum, we could use for same for the cells also. It works well. But it does well. We can able to classify cervical cancers, including it works. And in case of ethnic cancers, it works. We worked on different stages, including even the prognosis prediction, you can see. Suppose when you record the spectra of cells which move to tumors, that means there is a possibility that this guy has a problem of getting other cancer. Because we take from both sides. We took from the tumor side, we take from the contralateral side. If the cells of contralateral match with tumor, then this person is in trouble. He has to be examined again. So like that we did, and also we did for pre-malignant, it works. I will show you one very interesting data for you. This is basically tell you where Raman does what conventional techniques cannot do. Some of you must be knowing that the cells are different types, squamous, columnar are different cells. All these cells have their own features. Some can be picked up, some cannot be picked up. And if it is cell typing, if two different cells, you can pick it up. Now suppose there is a cancer from cervical cancer, it comes from the squamous cell. Oral cancer, it also comes from the squamous cell. Suppose we record spectra of them, are they different? Are they not different? Because if you give cells from head neck cancer or cervical cancer to a cytologist, he will say whether they're good or bad, but they can't tell you what is the site of origin. Is it coming from the mouth or it's coming from the cells? Can't say. But as you can see, they are very different. All these things are very different. Our percentage of efficiency is 80, 85 kind of things, even 100% in some cases. That means they can not only do it's a cancer or non-cancer. It can also do models for different conditions. If you develop a big model for having all different cancers with their diseases and you record a spectrum of cells and you can tell you whether it is cancer or not cancer, it doesn't matter whether what is the site of origin. Say for example, when we did in vivo Raman, we did on subsides of the mouth. Now we are doing from completely different two organs. Still it works. So that is the beauty of these techniques. This technology has a great advantage that way. So now I come to the last side of it, that is last areas, that is basically non-cancer indications. We did something on the asthma, we did something on meningiomas, which are brain conditions, very good able to classify them well. And you could also do the classification between dengue and malaria, which is, they look very similar, but it's very difficult to separate them. That also you could do it. It works very well. So, and we also did something on saliva in COVID. And here we use saliva for that. What we did, we took saliva samples in which we added RNA virus, and we see whether we can classify them or not. It works. That means it's, and it can tell you immediately. We don't need to wait for RT-PCR results to tell you. We can just tell you immediately. In fact, we have some other data also, which I'm not presenting here because still to be published. You can easily do it. Somebody I have seen, you're all, one of your group are working on ACRS. This maybe you can think of doing it. It's a microfluidic based idea where you can do, you can easily develop to not only virus detection, you can also type the virus, which type of virus, based on what the nanoparticle substrate are improvising nanoparticles, you can do it. So this could be interesting area to some of you to work out. It's a very interesting line to work if you're ACRS and nanoparticle based people. But in general, yes, it works. Then what next? One of the problem is, as I think Fani Indra was talking about, the doctor doesn't want all these things. He wants just green, red, yellow. That is, green is good, red is bad, yellow is watchful. So he needs the tissue. So for that, you have to make entire thing to be analysis to be online. And it's doable, it's not that difficult. But what really difficult is, suppose I have my Raman machine, I have recorded spectra and all those things. I have my friend somewhere in France or somewhere, but he doesn't use the same instrument, he doesn't use same conditions. Can I take this data, can I use these models to work? That's where we are stuck. Unless this part has to be sorted out, that is, data can be adjusted, it will not, things don't work. And also, when you go for in vivo, we need to have a big bundles. Then another point, and minimally invasive, we are trying to still improvise, and we have one of our colleagues who is working on animal models. She's recording spectrum from healthy condition of animal to the tumor conditions, and we want to see at what stage we can really classify. We see we can classify at very early stages also. So if that all works, I think that will be very interesting. And last, this is the most crucial thing, because some of us want to know what is the marker you are doing. You are recording the spectrum, you are seeing classified. What is giving you classification? Is it just a PCLDI just picks up the pattern and tells you what is what? Which group is this? But that's all, it's basically a statistics game. Where is your molecule coming up here? Generally, so far we have been working only on that. We're trying to classify, but now we have means to look into the spectrum from the point of view of biomolecules. We recently have a couple of papers on that line also. Hopefully we'll come up with maybe a biomarker and a reason for why the classification is happening. If you can do that, that is a big, very big achievement for us. So I close here. These are my gang, not present people. Some of the people are left. Thanks a lot.
Sairam sir, thank you for your elaborative and insightful presentation. Yeah. There are some questions in the chat box. Sir can answer. And also a few questions from the people presenting here.
Where is the chat box? I don't know.
Sir, we'll read out the question.
Is here? This one. Okay. Okay.
The last question, sir.
PCLDA models. Actually, you know, the PCA, PCLDA depends on, there are some standard rules to have that. Ideally, what you should do is when you work on PCA, suppose you have 50 samples, ideally you should start 26 components for it, well, plus one. Then try to see the variance plot. From that, you can understand how many factors will give you the classification. For example, first 10 or 15 are giving you, say, 80%, 90%, then that is enough for you. Most often what happens is first 3-4 factors will tell you the entire story. You don't need more than that. So if you can do that, that is only information. Secondly, when you go for LDA, PCLDA, there's a standard rule. Standard rule is, suppose you have 4 group model, and tumors and LDA and tobacco guys and pre-malignants. Pre-malignants are about 10 cases, whereas other are 100 cases. In that case, the rule is the lowest group is 10. So you have to do off minus 1. Suppose that off is 5, minus 1, 4. So you can use only 4 components, you can't use more. Otherwise, you are overfitting the data. And when it comes to, as a generally a thumb rule is, don't do more than 10 factors. Otherwise, for PCA, PCLDA, 10 should be the maximum number of cases you can use.
Hello, sir. Thank you very much for the very Interesting talk. I have two questions. One is for publications, do you require to take ethics committee clearance?
Yes, yes, it's a must.
So you have taken the ethics committee clearance and then only you have done this?
Yeah, yes.
Okay,
if you don't do that one, the project can be blocked.
Then that ex vivo is different from in vitro, is it?
Yes.
Ex vivo, in vitro is where simulation wise they do.
No, actually, no, ex vivo, in vivo, in vitro, these are little difference. What we call ex vivo is, suppose you take a biopsy, you work as such, you have not modified it. That we call it in vivo, ex vivo. In vitro is basically cell lines. Basically cell lines. It's a biopsy we picked up from the human being, you are using as such. That's why we use the word ex vivo. We're not doing on the person, but you're taking out of the person. That's why we call it ex vivo. I think somebody like a biology fellow might say that it could also in vitro. Right, Shama? Technically, it's also in vitro, right? Yeah. But we call it ex vivo because we have not modified anything. You have taken a specimen as such.
How much time does it take, sir? I think I missed that some part of yours.
It's not more than 5 seconds to 10 seconds to record spectrum. And you generally, to improve the signal to noise ratio, you should do maybe 5 times. So typically, maybe 10 minutes to 15 minutes, one patient can be completed.
Okay. And what's the wavelength which you use, sir?
I have two lasers, 785 and 532. Ideally, 785 is the best, because 532 can give resonance Raman. That can, because of the resonance lines, you can get a classification. So it's
and
not
the good. Power generally?
Power, there's a strong rule. The rule, especially when you are working on a patient, it should be never more than 100 milliwatt for 1 micron area. That is the highest you can use. So what we use is 60 to 70 in 100 micron area.
100 micron, okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I have one question. Are you planning to miniaturize your entire device so that it is some kind of a small point of care device with very small form factor?
I think already I showed you from tabletop, it became a portable instrument. It can't be lesser than that. The reason is, see, the problem is you need to have a spectrograph to disperse, right? The spectrograph has to be certain distance, right? It should be at least maybe 10 centimeter long. Otherwise, you can't see anything. Because the laser lines are, see, when you use 785 or 532, you have to pick up from 800 to 1800 range. It's equivalent in the wavelengths. So you need to have a dispersion. Other option you can do is, which I told Chandra Bose of the Jawaharlal Nehru Center, was that, see, what is happening is, we can do a classification based on lines at lipid versus proteins, which comes at 1750 and 1650 area. So what you can use, you can pick up the band from, can use a band pass filter, just put it at, which can pick up from 1650 wave numbers to say 1700 wave numbers into one channel, and 1700 to 1750 are like that area in another, this one, take a ratio of it. In that case, the instrument becomes smaller. It just can be, all you need is just a laser and two detectors with a band pass filters. But the problem here is you are detecting everything based on two lines, that is 1650 line and 1750 line. It's not good.
Sir, there are a few more questions from the audience. One of the question is, how Raman spectroscopy is advantageous over the microscopy methods to detect the cancers?
Ideally speaking, I personally feel if you are working on an patient, microscopy has no role to play, because you can't just microscope, put it on a patient. It's impossible. Microscopy is basically, if you want to work on saliva, serum, you can work. Because essentially what you are doing, you know, like in the first lecture, as you said, it's a, you know, basically it's non-linear phenomena, Raman. So you need to have a lot of photons concentrating on one particular area. And it also depends on the number of molecules in that. So suppose you are using serum of 30 micrometers, you have to focus this one into, say, 1 or 2 microns spot with about, say, 20 to 25 milliwatt laser on this one. Then only get a signal, otherwise you won't get a signal. That's not possible using in vivo Raman machine, which has a, which, you know, like with a spot size of 100 to 200 micron area, it's not possible. So microscope is good for if you are working on saliva, serum, or if you are working on patients or animals, you should work out using the normal spectroscopy methods.
So there was one more question from one of our faculty. How is the therapeutic aspect dealt?
I was talking to you about one thing, that is head neck cancers are notorious for having the recurrence. So that's what we could able to see by when the person came, we recorded spectra on both sides, because you have to build the model for control and contralateral, that's the opposite side of the tumor side. So by looking at the opposite side of the tumor, which is supposed to be healthy, we can talk about whether the patient is getting a second cancer or not. That is one way of looking at therapeutic. Second way of looking at it, suppose surgery is done, still is he getting the sample, still his serum samples are changing. That is one way of looking at whether surgery is done properly or not. There is third thing which I didn't talk about it. What happens is when you give drugs to this one, sometimes drug resistance is seen, and drug resistance cannot be picked up so easily. Or when you give radiation, for example, cervical cancer, it's always we give radiation to treat the patient. And after radiation, we'll know only whether the patient has responded or not after, say, 4 months. Suppose you record spectra, because you have to give 20 fractions of radiation, 5 fractions a week. Like that, you have to do for 1 month, then you have to do 2 treatments. And finally, after 1 month after the radiation, you just check whether the patient is responding or not. That is, tumor has shrunk, or it is same, or it is increasing. There are 3 conditions. One is tumor shrunk, but it has not completely gone. In one case, tumor has started growing, tumor just stopped. So all these things can be done if you record spectrum of on the patient on the second day after radiation treatment. We found it works. If you take first day without treatment, you can't make out. But after the treatment, if you do it, you can make out whether patient is going to respond or not going to respond. That is a therapeutic aspect which we dealt. And also we can see whether resistant cases can be picked up or not. We can do that. Hypoxic, that is another reason why treatment doesn't work. Those people can be picked up. And these are, we are doing it, but it has not gone up to the level of what we did on cancer detection. Cancer detection, yes, it's ready to go to the public, but these things have to be improved.
It's on. Thank you so much, sir, for your very inspiring talk. Shining light on importance of undertaking translational research in healthcare, especially in developing countries.